Now you're up to date on News Talk.
The Olympic Show on OTB Sports with Indeed, proud partner of Team Ireland.
You are watching the Olympic Show on OTB Sports with Indeed, proud partner of Team Ireland. We're live every day across the next 3 weeks on all of our social channels, and it's all with thanks to Indeed, who proudly support Team Ireland at the 2020 Tokyo Olympics. Indeed believes the world works better when people are given the opportunity to unleash their true talents. The hashtag to follow for Team Ireland at the Olympic Games is hashtag talent unleashed. So today on the Olympic Show, we've decided to cast our eye ahead at Ireland's debut in rugby sevens at the Olympic Games after the Irish men's team secured qualification in dramatic circumstances last month, winning the repechage in Monaco. So they're in Group C alongside South Africa, USA and Kenya. We've three groups of four, top two qualify for the quarterfinals, as well as two of the best third place teams. And from there, you're into the medal games. Ireland begin against South Africa and USA tomorrow morning, 3 a.m. Irish time is the first of those games. So it's going to be either a late night for someone watching that or an early start. And looking ahead, I'm delighted to be joined by former Ireland Sevens and 15s international Louise Galvin. Louise, thanks a million for joining us this afternoon.
No problem. Thanks for having me.
So the Irish Sevens programme debuting at the Olympic Games, 6 years in the making. You were there since day one in the women's sevens squad back in 2015. I know obviously the women's team, you came so close to getting there for Rio 2016, and unfortunately the women's team didn't make it this time round either. But will it fill you with an enormous amount of pride knowing you were there from day one 6 years ago when all this was started?
Yeah, well, I suppose to go back a step, there was a women's sevens programme previous to that, and they would have competed in the Sevens World Cup in Moscow a few years prior to that as well. And there just hadn't been a men's team, I think, until 2015. So I guess when David Nusafora came in and brought in Anthony Eddy, director of sevens, maybe that's when the sevens program in its current guise kind of got up and running again. And I would have been there, I think I'm there since 2015. I think Anthony Eddy came in around December 2015 or 2014 potentially. And yeah, he got the women's program, he got it, I suppose, up and running in a more kind of formalized, contracted way. And then along with that came the men's program, which was unfortunate because they hadn't been competing. As is well publicized at this stage, they had to go to the likes of Bosnia and compete against similar non-traditional rugby nations in Division C of the European Championships. And what's particularly romantic about this squad that are now taking to the field in Tokyo this week is that there's actually a sizable number of that contingent that have been involved, the OGs, as they call themselves, since day one in that tournament in Bosnia, and a few more that came in very quickly after that. So that's really pleasing to see, that the guys that have worked so hard, that toiled through Europe to get through Division C, B, A, are now the ones that will be taken to the field for Ireland's debut in the Olympics in rugby sevens. So I guess, in fact, your question, what do I feel? I feel very proud. I'm very, very excited for the guys. They're not just representing themselves and their country, they're representing the whole sevens programme, male and female, and they're a sound bunch of lads, and I just wish them all the very best.
Yeah, to talk more about the guys in the squad, because as you said, you would be a fairly close-knit group of teams, you would have travelled together so much, so I imagine you know a lot of the characters in that Ireland squad. And as you also said as well, you have some of those, which is great to see, that have been there since day one and maybe the first year or two. So it hasn't been a team that's, you know, been constantly changing, or we've had an enormous amount of high profile players just jettisoned in for an Olympic Games. That these are guys who were out, like some of these fellas were out there in Bosnia and a lot of these lower profile rugby nations back in 2015 and 2016 in the early days of all this. And talking specifically maybe about someone like Harry McNulty or the current captain Billy Dardis as well, guys who have really, really had to fight for their rugby careers.
Yeah, and I guess that's where, in women, there's kind of close-knit pathways between sevens and 15s, but there wouldn't necessarily be one above the other. Look, a lot of the guys would have been originally started out their rugby careers hoping to make it in the 15s game, and for whatever reason didn't, or as they came up through the academy system, just took a little sidestep over to sevens. And I think already, look, we're focusing on the Olympics, but we're already seeing the byproduct of that with some of the talent that is now playing, and not just provincial but international 15s rugby for Ireland. But coming back to the lads, like, fair play to them, because, you know, it's not, I suppose, a very well-paid gig, certainly not compared to the 15s job. But if you work hard, once the guys get on the series, it is a lovely lifestyle to have for a couple of years. If you don't have a huge amount of responsibility at home, you're travelling around the world on the World Series, ordinarily, COVID aside, you get treated pretty well on those trips as well. And, you know, getting to see amazing parts of the world. So the guys had that as one of their carrots, is getting on the World Series. They achieved that. They also would have gone to the repechage for the Rio Olympics and would have missed out. They actually did quite well, and then kind of got caught in the hop in the quarterfinal, I believe against Spain in Monaco that time, and probably just weren't as prepared. But I think having gone through the qualifiers for the World Series in Hong Kong and that kind of must-win tournament set them up in great stead for Monaco last month. And it's kind of a funny one, because in one way, like, they don't have any heat camps done because they're obviously waiting to qualify so late. But they're the only team that have played a really important high-pressure tournament essentially this season, because the whole World Series was cancelled. So teams have been trying to meet up to play in tournaments that probably the most important thing in the tournament was getting selection for the Olympics, as opposed to the team winning, apart from the repechage. So in that way, the guys will be coming in with kind of a bit, maybe a bit more battle hardened than some of the other teams that are coming in. But I also, going back to your point about knowing them well, like, it is quite a close-knit community, the sevens community. We were initially set up the female squad, so they would have come in, and they weren't even all based in Dublin. I used to come up for training camps midweek or at the weekend, and a lot of the guys who didn't live in Dublin were even just staying in hotels. So we would have shared a lot of the same training facilities with all the same coaches. And even if guys and girls were going to main tournaments, the injured pack were usually back together, training in the gym together, doing skill sessions together. So it actually is quite a close-knit community. Obviously, we train separately completely when it comes to contact, but they would have been a big part of our preparation as well. And I'd like to think, hopefully, that we had them out along the way too.
Yeah, certainly. It's very interesting you made the point as well that Ireland are maybe one of the only, if not the only, team that has had proper competition in the last year, because rugby sevens was a sport that was hit incredibly hard by COVID, and not just with cancellation of fixtures and cancellation of all the various meetings as well, but looking at England, like, they essentially disassembled their entire sevens program, and it's only thanks to lottery funding in the UK that the Team GB have been able to be funded and have been able to train. So sevens is something that was really, really hit by COVID. And to go back to what you said then, Ireland have had a high-pressure tournament under their belt recently enough. And it probably means that it's going to be a fairly wide-open tournament.
Yeah, it's massively going to be wide-open because there's very little form to look at. I mean, you know, there's Oceania Sevens recently, so you would have had New Zealand, Fiji, Australia playing each other. The USA, who Ireland have in their group, they came over and played Ireland and GB over in GB there, just as the guys were preparing for Monaco. There's a lot of these kind of small tournaments, but they don't have the same intensity. They try to replicate the six games in 3 days, as opposed to what usually happens in the World Series of six games in 2 days. They try to replicate that kind of a setup, obviously, and trying to make it as close as possible. But even when you bring it down to the conditions, I mean, you would say GB and Ireland were playing in GB and it rained half the time. So that's not going to be what they're going to face in Tokyo this week. So at least the guys were in Monaco. It was pretty hot over there as well. And, you know, had to, when they put their shoulders to the wheel, they had to have a must-win game against France, and they controlled that game. And France are no slouches. Like, if they had beaten Ireland, they wouldn't be out of place talking about a medal hope. So it's against quality opposition as well, once it came to the business end of that qualifying tournament. So there certainly will be coming in, maybe a little bit under the radar. They're obviously in an incredibly difficult group, but there are a few little side stories that might be helping them. For example, unfortunately for South Africa in their holding camp, on the flight over, they seem to have had some interaction with COVID, and their head coach, Neil Powell, who's been their coach for years, He contracted COVID, so he's not allowed to attend the games. He's managing or coaching virtually, and the assistant coach has officially stepped into the role of head coach on the sidelines. And then along with that, half their squad were deemed close contact. So once they arrived into Japan, they had to quarantine in a separate hotel with half the squad that weren't close contact. So COVID has really interrupted their preparation. They were only allowed to meet in the training pitch from a certain period on. So that'll be, I suppose, potentially a positive for Ireland. But South Africa, they got a bronze medal in Rio, and they would have been disappointed with that because of the form they would have brought into that tournament. They were going for a gold or a silver, so they're going to be pushing to go one or two better at this tournament. USA in the World Series prior to COVID have been incredibly strong, both in men's and women's. They're seriously medal contenders. But again, the guys are really well against them over in GB in the run-up to that Monaco tournament, and they have beaten them in the past. Like all these teams, essentially, the guys have either put it up to or beaten. So it's a case of, you know, what form teams do bring in to the tournament, because there's been so little form because essentially there has been no World Series this year.
Yeah, and I think you made a good point. Like the USA, they qualified automatically as one of the top four a couple of years back for Tokyo 2020. So I think maybe a lot of rugby fans who don't have a huge experience of sevens probably need to remember that it is very, very different. Like the USA, you'd look at in the 15s game as maybe a bit of a pushover, but when it comes to sevens, they are right up there with as good in the world.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And that's in both men's and women's. Like sevens isn't about your traditional powerhouses per se at all. And it, like even in Kenya, we have to absolutely respect they're absolute beasts of men. Like to see them up close, they're every single one of them is absolutely huge. Whereas, you know, we aren't the biggest, and we've a few guys who you mightn't see their stature in any of the other teams. But we've got an excellent skill set, a really hard work ethic, and the team is very settled. So again, like you've the likes of Fiji bringing in a Semi Rodraja, super exciting. You know, some of the other guys have brought in a few, the odd 15s player, but I think Ireland have a very settled, cohesive unit. Only Gavin Mullen wouldn't have played in the World Series, and he was doing really, really well. He just missed out in Monaco due to injury. He's a big guy, he's a powerful guy. So the only thing with him is he probably hasn't been exposed to playing in that kind of a hot, humid environment. The other guys would have been in the World Series. So there's still a lot going in our side, going in our favour. And as you mentioned, 8 out of the 12 teams will essentially get into the quarterfinal. But yet, if you're not on top of your game, it's very easy to miss out on one of those 8 spots. So the guys will be looking to get into the quarterfinal. Again, if you end up being one of the best placed third, you're going to be playing the number one or the number two seed. So whether that's going to be a New Zealand or a Fiji. So again, you're up against it again. So you're trying to get into a top spot or at least a second seed to make your quarterfinal just a little bit more, I suppose, tenable.
And one thing you mentioned there, obviously, was the conditions and the heat that the players are used to playing in. We're probably still unsure what the conditions are going to be like, because there is reportedly a tropical storm on the way in, and that's after pushing the rowing, for example, back a couple of days. That's been postponed again until Wednesday. So there is a fair chance it could be, you know, a deluge of rain while these players are playing. But there is also the possibility in between that there's going to be a lot of dead heat, a lot of humidity. You made a good point, though, that for a lot of sports in the Olympic cycle, a lot of the Irish teams will talk about all the heat training they have to do. But because pretty much all of this squad have been used to the World Series program over the last couple of years and all the travelling, you have series in Hong Kong, you have series in Abu Dhabi and places like that, where heat is a massive factor. These players are relatively used to playing in those conditions.
Yeah, they are. So they're relatively used to how to get that core temperature down as much as possible, how to save themselves between games, 2 games a day, but it's fairly spread out. I think that, you know, there's a talking about 7-8 hour gap between games. So all that logistics will be looked after by management, whether it's best off to go back to the village in between games, or if they're allowed, or to stay where they are and in air conditioned space. One thing about Japan, I know obviously COVID said its influence on all the games, and all the sports, but I've played a few World Series tournaments in Japan, and their attention to detail, their level of preparation is just phenomenal. So I'd be damn sure that wherever the guys are staying between games, that it's going to be a well-contained air-conditioned space, because they just would have that attention to detail. The players would have gone through it themselves. The management are well in tune. They'll have the nutritional advice and all the strength conditioning advice on how to prepare as best as possible. So that should be relatively manageable for the guys. And it's the same for both teams. Whoever they're playing against is going to be suffering just as much.
For those who wouldn't really be too used to sevens over the 15s game, and we do have a lot of people when it comes to an Olympics who will dive headfirst into a sport and make it their passion for a few days, what can you tell us about the game that you think sets it apart over the 15s game, or what people should be excited about seeing?
You just can't take your eyes off the screen. Like, the pace of the game is phenomenal. The work rate is huge. Like, I've been lucky enough, as I mentioned, I've played rugby 15, sevens internationally. I've played international basketball and intercounty football. Nothing compares to the intensity and the work rate required for international rugby sevens. It is a different beast altogether. You're so reliant on the people either side of you, your teammates, that even though you have your standout stars like your Jordan Conroy's or Terry Kennedy's for our guys, they're so reliant on the men inside and outside of them. Being in the wrong position by half a foot, half an inch, can completely upset your defensive line. And then the swing, like, you can get a 14-point swing so easily. Let's say you make a line break. If you can't back yourself to the line, well, immediately, as soon as you're caught, you're a turnover threat and your defence is a shambles. So then they could score as a 7-pointer. So there's just constant, you're making really high-pressure decisions at the top end of your, I suppose, physical prowess, your speed, and you're under incredible fatigue when you're trying to do it. And the last thing you want to do is leave your teammates down. It's to miss a tackle. It's to put a pass too far in front or too far behind someone. So it's just such a huge squad effort. And it's trying to make these incredible tackles, incredible line breaks when you're under the maximum amount of fatigue possible. And yet there's something so exhilarating and contagious about it that you go out and you do it again a few hours later.
Aside from a gigantic set of lungs, what does a good sevens player need?
You do need a cool head, because you need to be able to, you need a massive fitness level, but you need to make these decisions under extreme pressure. But look, ideally, if you want to pick your ideal sevens player, they've got to be big, fast and strong. There's no point just being big if you can't move, so you need to add in a bit of agility as well. And they need to want to have to outwork the person opposite them. You know, they need to know that their mind is the first thing they'll tell them to stop, not their body. And they need to ignore that mind and just go to absolute death's door to blow out their lungs, their legs, whatever they need to do to get the win.
You mentioned how the Irish squad probably aren't as big physically as some of the other teams there, but what would the Irish squad have that could give them an edge?
What I mentioned there, they're very cohesive, they're a very settled unit, these guys have been playing together, injuries aside, but for years. But they're very agile, very skillful. Everyone can pass 18, 20 metres off their left and their right hand accurately with pace on in front. They know each other's strengths, so they very much know how to play, how each other plays. Like, then, you know, Harry knows he's not going to run the length of the field and score a blitz of a try, but if he makes a line break, he's going to make sure he retains the ball, maybe keeps it alive, and then try and find a bit of space for the speedsters to put the ball away. So they're very in tune with how they want to play. And compared to maybe some of the other guys, they've good rugby brains, and they're also just very agile. So our guys, like, everyone can step. They don't want to just run over the top of you, I guess. A lot of guys can't just run over the top, but they use that to try and get a soft shoulder, try and get an offload, try and keep it alive. But at the same time, when it's not on, you know, they're not Fiji either. If the offload isn't on, they'll just work in their pods of three, recycle, get that ball away again. And in sevens, if you can hold on to the ball and hold on to possession, you're also starving the opposition of possession. You're keeping them defending, which is more energy sapping usually. And then as well, they have a good solid set piece. So set piece is not as important as in the 15s game, but it's still quite an important launch play. And like our guys, like possession is huge. We're talking about 7 minutes. So we've an excellent kickoff strategy, both in attack and defence. We've guys that can get up and get their hands on the ball. And if you want to see accuracy, watch Billy Dardis this weekend. Watch Mark Roach kick the ball 10, 12 metres on the money with height in it so that we can get a tap back and we can get that possession. Because it's not like 15s where you just use the kickoff to restart a game. You're using it to try and win the ball back immediately. So just around those minute details, our line out, our scrum, they're all pretty solid, so we can use them as attacking plays. So there's just a few little things like that that sets our guys apart. But I think the main thing at this stage is their cohesion and their work rate for each other.
Given the Irish men's sevens program is really only it's still quite a young process. You're talking 6 years. Is it fair to say that this is, and I'm using the phrase that Richie and Cliona Foley used on this Olympics show a couple of days back, talking about some of the younger Team Ireland members, but is this almost like the Olympics before the real Olympics for them, that, you know, in 4 years' time, when they have an enormous amount more experience, that they could really, really be contenders on a world stage?
Look, for the guys taking to the field at 3 a.m. in the morning, Irish time, they're not going to be thinking that. I suppose for it, the Irish Sevens program, you could say, is relatively in its infancy, and we're only on the World Series as a core team 2 years, and obviously COVID has scuppered one of those years. But for a lot of these guys personally, you know, they're mid to late 20s. I wouldn't necessarily say they're all going to be hanging around for Paris 2024. The other thing is that, and I mentioned, look, it's not a hugely financially viable sport either, unless again the Olympics helps to maybe even raise some of the commercial elements for the guys and for the squads, which would be fantastic if they did. So that's another element. I mean, I know I don't want to speak for the guys, I don't know personally, but I wouldn't necessarily say everyone there is looking to Paris 2024 as when they would like to medal. But certainly in terms of the Irish Sevens squad, they look to build from strength to strength. And the goals of the strategic plan for Sevens was only published during the week, and it's to have both men and women in Paris in 2024. Certainly from a female point of view, what will help is that it's so difficult to get into the Olympics because it's proportional representation. So both our men and women are top 12 teams in world rugby, absolutely. But Europe is so strong, it's hard to get out. So even the fact that it was in Rio and Tokyo the last few times, that was an Asian and some South American team, plus they got one extra team in that aren't even on the World Series. Whereas now we'll have France automatically qualified, which will take someone away from Europe and make qualification a little bit more achievable for our squad. So I think getting both squads to Paris 2024 is going to be really important. And obviously medaling would be a huge hope, but these guys have an outside chance this weekend and they know it. I believe they think they've more than an outside chance. They could ruffle a lot of feathers in this group.
Yeah, you've kind of just answered my final question there. I was going to ask, like, how viable is a medal prospect for this bunch? Like, they seem to be outsiders, but they do look like outsiders who have full belief in themselves.
Well, I'll put it to you this way: they were coming in as the last seed. No one wanted them in their group as a last seed. They're the worst last seed to get in. They've haven't been on the series long enough to build up consistent victories over the real top seeds, but they've knocked pretty much all of them off their perch at some stage. So, look, sevens, it's important to start well and at least get into the quarterfinals, but then it's scrapped. It's all about cup rugby at that stage and it's knockout. So I think, you know, like I mentioned, South Africa have had their preparations a little bit scuppered by COVID. So if we get even if we don't win, but if we start well against South Africa, because again, they're one of the definitely one medal contenders, it'll take a lot of confidence into the USA game and then Kenya to finish up to hopefully cement a quarterfinal place. These guys will be looking at least a quarterfinal place and hopefully beyond that.
Well, Louise, I hope you enjoy it and hope you're not too tired watching them at 3 a.m. On Monday morning. Thanks a million for joining us on the Olympic show.
No problem. Thanks, Neil.
That is the Olympic show here on OTB Sports with Indeed, proud partner of Team Ireland. Indeed believes the world works better when people are given the opportunity to unleash their true talents. The hashtag to follow for Team Ireland is hashtag talent unleashed.
The Olympic show on OTB Sports with Indeed, proud partner of Team Ireland.
There you are. That was Neil Tracy in conversation with Louise Galvin. Let's go.